Stress and compensations, the body's responses to life's demands. We all understand that we're under stress, and we all understand that stress can impact our system. What we want to discuss today is how stress impacts all the systems of our bodies, and how we can incorporate that information into the care of our patients. Stress is unavoidable for any of us because it surrounds us. It's in every aspect of our life. When we want to define what stress actually is, though, we should think of stress as a state of disharmony. Stress is a state of threatened homeostasis, and it can be provoked with psychological, environmental, or physiologic forces. If we want to help our patients resolve their symptoms and to restore their function, we have to be aware of the interaction of all of our stressors, the systems that are affected, and the resultant physiologic or physical changes which can occur within the body. The origins of stress are going to be external or internal in nature. External stressors are those things that we as therapists feel more comfortable with. Whether we're talking about a car accident that would be short duration, high impact stressors, or we're talking about recreational or vocational stressors, those low impact but long duration forces. And in considering those type of stresses, we have to include our postures and our movement habits. Internal stressors are ones that you may not be as comfortable with because they deal with thoughts, emotions, and the past experiences of the patients. As we'll learn today, they all play an equally important role in restoring that sense of wellness to a patient. I think of healing as a reactive effort, that something's wrong and I want to try and fix it. Focusing instead on wellness focuses on restoring homeostasis, harmony to the system, and that's our real objective with our patients. Every system of the body is impacted with the input of stress into the system, and we're going to look at each of those. When we talk about physical compensations, I'm not just referring to the musculoskeletal disorders that can occur with our patients, but remember that physical compensations refer to anatomical, physiologic, and biochemical changes which do occur because of our stressors. Your response to stress, whether it's external or internal, is going to be mediated through the central nervous system. And so in our journey to understand stressors, the first thing that we'll look at is processing of our external stressors. That means we're going to look at how stimuli enter for processing. Secondly, how the brain puts that information into context or assigns it a meaning, and therefore that it can appropriately, hopefully, respond with either a peripheral or an internal response to reinstate wellness or homeostasis. Let's look first then at how information gets from the outside to the inside of the brain. Your peripheral nervous system measures the world around you and provides that information through a system of what are known as information or damage receptors. These receptors, known as nociceptors, are triggered by and relay the information related to temperature, mechanical, and chemical environments of the body. Mechanical can be thought to represent, for example, pressures, sharp, dull, those kind of mechanical loads. Whereas chemical may refer to the natural chemicals of the body, hormones, neurotransmitters, but also to the chemicals that are a part of a disharmony state of the body. Chemicals from tissue tearing, buildup of chemicals from ischemia, and so forth. The information goes from the periphery through the nociceptors to the dorsal root ganglia, which is also known as the mini brain. In the dorsal root ganglia, that's where the initial processing occurs. And the dorsal root ganglia may make the determination that from the information that just came in, we can handle this at a spinal cord level. And so no information needs to be relayed to the brain. On the other hand, the dorsal root ganglia is a bit, it's a bit nervous at all times. And so it may want to relay the information up to the cortex because it seems that there is a threat coming in from the periphery. Now, the dorsal root ganglia really is like a toddler that needs a nap on occasion. It's just going off way too much. The brain controls the information from the dorsal root ganglia by providing a constant, steady stream of inhibitory chemicals. When the brain wants more information, it decreases inhibition. When the brain determines that it does not have enough information to draw a context or a meaning to this information so that it can't yet decide what response is appropriate, then it will decrease the inhibition and allow that information to come into play. So the brain, through this inhibitory chemical network, has the ability to increase and decrease dorsal root ganglia activity. Now we have the information in the brain, and we have to look at how is the brain going to determine what does this information mean. In school, you may have learned one or both of these models. At my age, we began thinking of patients in pain in terms of the structural pathology model. Today, we'll discuss the structural pathology model as well as the neuromatrix model. In the structural pathology model, pain is in direct proportion to the damage, the structural damage that's out there in the periphery. So if I have 5 out of 10 pain, I've got 5 out of 10 structural damage, proportionate damage to pain ratio. So that means if I have pain, something is definitely wrong. Something is being damaged. So it's a time for us to be concerned as a system. But let's think about how reasonable a structural pathology model is. If pain has an equal and is a solid measure of damage, then I should be able to do a test, an x-ray, lab work. I should be able to find that structural damage of that individual. And yet think about how often your patients come to you and they've had all manners of tests and procedures, and yet still the reason the patient in pain is not known, cannot be discovered. If pain equals damage, then damage should equal pain. I love this chart, and I love to show this chart to my patients in making this point to them, because this chart illustrates that you can have damage and not have pain. So in fact, at age 57, an age I'm very proud of, at age 57, 80% of people evaluated on x-ray will demonstrate degenerative joint disease and yet have no pain, have no symptoms from it. Then 100% of patients by 57 will demonstrate that they have cracks in the annular fibers. And at least 60% will demonstrate that they have some degree of herniation of their discs on CAT scan or MRI, and yet feel no discomfort. As we can see then, thinking in terms of this direct cause and effect relationship is not an accurate reflection of how pain is generated in our system or why pain is generated. So what we're going to consider now is the neuromatrix model. And this model was actually identified by a gentleman by the name of Melzack in 1999. Let's look at the definition. Pain is a complex, multi-system, disproportionate response generated by a network of cells within the central nervous system in response to an actual or perceived threat. Let's look at that again. Pain is complex. It is multi-system. It is disproportionate. It is a response from the central nervous system in reference to an actual or perceived threat. Many areas of the brain are involved in processing information and in specifically processing nociceptive or potential damage threat information that comes in from the periphery. We'll look at all these areas. The primary areas that are considered part of this pain network, or this damage network rather, would be our anterior cingulate cortex, our prefrontal cortex, the somatosensory cortex, our thalamus, and our insulin cortex. Let's look at each of them individually. We have the area known as the periaqueductal gray, which is responsible for the generation of opiates. This allows us to modulate our perception of pain. The second area is the amygdala, and this is an area that's really related to emotions in all situations, not just our discussion of nociceptive input. So emotion-based memories are formed in the amygdala and stored and processed in the amygdala. The amygdala has the ability to influence the central nervous system, and it has the ability to influence adrenaline production. And in just a little bit, we'll talk about just my favorite thing, adrenaline production. We have the hypothalamus, and the hypothalamus likewise can regulate the central nervous system and regulate the pituitary that will be involved in some of the hormone responses that will occur. It is the hypothalamus that actually links our nervous system and our endocrine system, and it stimulates through a chain reaction of chemicals, through a chain reaction of hormones, once again, adrenaline production. The nucleus accumbens is involved in our perception of that information and regards it as either something that is a reward, something that is to be feared, or something in fact that is pleasurable. This is the area of the brain that is also involved in producing an inhibitory neurotransmitter, GABA, for the central nervous system. So this is an area that helps calm the central nervous system back down. The anterior cingulate cortex, one of the primary nociceptive processing areas, is involved in attention, motivation, and modulates emotions. So we have the amygdala, which is an emotion processing center, and we have the anterior cingulate cortex that again is trying to modulate that emotional response to the present situation. What we know from functional MRIs is this area lights up anytime there is nociceptive stimulus coming in. Even more interesting to me is someone who is in a chronic pain state, this area stays chronically lit up or in a firing state. When we look at our prefrontal cortex, now we start bringing in the ability to consciously interact with the responses of the body. So it's the prefrontal cortex that's going to process and plan actions in reference to that nociceptive input. Am I being damaged or am I not being damaged? That's a question that the prefrontal cortex is involved in. In other words, conscious pain reduction, conscious pain perception. Interestingly enough, this area of the brain actually shrinks in a chronic pain state. And fortunately, that change is in fact reversible. We have a somatosensory cortex, and this is where we think of as the location of our homunculus. The homunculus is the location of all of the neurons that reflect where did that input just come from. And so in the somatosensory cortex, that is where the brain perceives the location that the information came from, as well as the intensity of that information that came in. We have our thalamus. And often people think of the thalamus as just a relay station, but there is initial processing that occurs at the thalamus for information that comes to the brain through the brainstem or from the spinal cord area. Finally, involved in this whole perception of the pain experience or the perception of the threat experience, more accurately, is the insulate cortex, the anterior insula especially. And in this area, we have our awareness of self. Awareness of self is something that we'll talk about in just a little bit and how that impacts the interpretation of the threat that's coming in. This, as by way of interest, is the area of the brain where it facilitates that I can feel pain when I see a painful thing. So you see something painful happen, and it just hurts to watch it happen. That's processed in that anterior insula. So in the neuromatrix model, what we're saying in essence is that pain is an output of the brain. It's not an input of the brain. And as you can see from the little yellow lines, that information bounces and moves to all different points in the brain. Then on functional MRI, the brain lights up in every area of the brain as this processing, this contextual processing occurs, to come up with what is the meaning of it so that a response can be determined. For us, we know that there are four things to consider in the neuromatrix model, or four primary concepts. The first one is that the amount of pain that you feel is not actually the amount of damage that you have. It's not proportionate. Number two, that external and internal stressors have an impact on the amount of pain that you feel. That the longer that pain continues, that the pain state continues, the less accurate it is. And finally, that believing that you are being injured is sufficient for you to feel pain. Let's take each of those concepts and flesh them out a little bit individually. We begin with the amount of pain that you feel is not the amount of damage that you have. And from functional MRI, what we know is that nociceptive activity is going to equal stimulus intensity. That's where the direct relationship ends. Because receptor activity, nociceptive firing activity, does not equate to a pain rating. The stimulus intensity does not match pain rating. And that receptor activity does not relate to the actual state of the tissues. The second concept, external and internal stressors, have an impact on the amount of pain you feel. What do we know from the science? We know that inflammation increases nociceptive firing. So if the tissues, if something is inflamed, the nociceptors will fire as if there is more damage being done, when in fact it's part of the inflammatory process. That when temperature of the tissues increases, nociceptive firing increases. When blood flow goes down, nociceptive firing goes up. And likely this is occurring through that chemical mediator, because as our blood flow goes down, our chemical ischemic products go up, nociceptive firing goes up. So without actual increased damage of the tissue, we can have increased firing of the damaged receptors. Then finally, looking at our internal stressors, we know from the research that attention, anxiety, and expectation has the ability to increase or decrease the amount of nociceptive firing. In other words, it's under an internal control which way the pain perception moves. What we know is that cognitive will always win. What you believe will impact nociceptive firing rates. This is a wonderful quote that I just wanted to just read it to you as is, because it's so perfect, that was coined by the author Melzack. Now I have to stop and give you a little piece of neuroscience history. In case you don't recognize the name Melzack, Dr. Melzack is actually a psychiatrist who first identified or verbalized the gait theory of pain back in the 1960s. Across time and across research, what he determined was that the gait theory was not an accurate reflection of how the brain processes. And so he, in 1999, coined the phrase the neuromatrix, or the neuromatrix model. So let's look at what that is. It is important for the purpose of understanding pain to keep in mind that stress is a biological system that is activated by physical injury, infection, or any threat to the body's homeostasis, whether it's from psychological insult or threat, once again, to the body threat. So in other words, my perception of potential danger has an impact in the system as strong as any physiologic force. But the most important thing in this quote to me is the concept that stress is a biological system It's not an isolated variable. Like when you were in school with connective tissue, and it was the stuff you ripped and got out of the way so you could see the circulatory system or the nervous system. And now we understand the connective tissue system is a primary system of the body. So we need to likewise understand that stress is a primary biological system of the body and treat it accordingly. Third variable, the longer pain continues, the less accurate it is. There are changes that occur in the nervous system the longer you perceive pain. The first is hyperalgesia, that your nociceptors excessively fire in reference to the amount of stimulus coming in. Secondly, allodynia, where stimulus that is non-threatening or non-damaging in nature can in fact be perceived as damaging in nature. It just as a little like psychological example of allodynia, think about the last time you were really happy with your spouse. You know, you're sitting on the sofa together and you're all cuddly and this, that, and the other, and he reaches over, you know, and he's patting your hair and it's all good. Then think about the last time you were really upset with your spouse and you're sitting on the sofa and you're trying to be a bit of an isolationist because you're not happy with them. But as a female, I can say, we want you to figure out what you did wrong. So we're not going to tell you about it. So we're sitting in our isolation shell on the sofa and you sit down and you start to pat my hair. And I'm like, stop that. That, you know, that hurts. Did it actually hurt or did it psychologically hurt? Allodynia is the perception of pain from previously non-painful stimulus. Two variables that have been very well researched and spoken to by Butler and Mosley are also the changes of what's known as smudging and laterality. And what we mean by this is the longer that pain goes on, in our corner here, we have our homunculus, and he has a little circle around his shoulder. So my pain started, let's say, in my shoulder. And let's say that it started in my right shoulder. So there's the little circle. The longer that there is a perception of pain, the more the neurons along the cortex, which is what the homunculus represents, become activated. This lets the individual perceive that the pain is spreading. Smudging is that there is activity spreading through the homunculus that, almost like rubbing your hand on a charcoal drawing, the information becomes smudged. It's hard for the brain to tell exactly where that input came from. So perhaps the input is still coming from the shoulder, but the body feels that it's spreading down the arm. At first my shoulder hurt, but now it moves into my arm and down into my forearm and down into my hand. So the question is your patient actually having a radiculopathy, or are they experiencing, because of the length of time of their pain experience, a smudging effect in the homunculus? And to take smudging a step further, the longer it goes on, the more that Butler and Mosley have identified that the patient loses the ability to determine even which side. So smudging happens across midline. Did that just come from my right shoulder or did that just come from my left shoulder? How do we see this clinically? The patient comes in and says, you know, the pain started here in the left side of my back and now it's moved to the right side of my back. In a structural pathology model, that wouldn't make any sense at all. Pain can't spread. But in a neuromatrix model, where we recognize that pain is an output, we can understand that through smudging, through this hypersensitivity of the cortex, the brain loses the ability to tell. It's probably still the left, but the brain is reading it as the right. The fourth variable or concept of the neuromatrix is believing that you're being injured is all it takes to feel pain. We'll discuss in more detail in just a little bit. So there are other factors that I want to highlight now before we move into response that affects how the central nervous system is going to process what the meaning of that information is. And we'll look at some non-genetic and some genetic variables. From a non-genetic standpoint, your past experience plays a role. Whether you've ever been in pain before or not, what you've learned in the environment that you've grown up in your culture. In my family, being of Scandinavian descent, you know, when you hurt yourself, you're expected to get back up and keep going. Now, I'm not saying that's right, but I'm saying that was my learning experience. That was the culture that I came from. Other individuals come from different cultures, different learning experiences. My mother knows that if she hurts herself, I'm coming over to the house and I'm going to fix whatever it is. So her past experience is one that I don't have to worry about the fact that I'm in pain. Internal stressor, thoughts, emotions, past experiences. I don't have to worry about it because Cheryl's just 4 miles down the street and she'll come and take care of me. Past experiences, but also present experiences. How many of your patients say, I bent over and I heard something pop? Scares the heck out of them. So sometimes our patients in the present have sensory experiences that feed into the stress that they're under. Our internal chemical environment. Do we have a heightened state of stress at the time of injury? Or what has happened prior to or during the event? Genetics just fascinates me in looking at how it plays a role in your perception of pain. There's a state called diathesis. This diathesis is actually the inherited state to your vulnerability, as the slide says, for a person under stress to become dysfunctional. So, genetics, some people can be under a lot of stress and never become dysfunctional or experience a pain experience, whereas others genetically have a much greater propensity for developing a dysfunctional state. Synthesis of proteins is something that's genetically controlled, and that controls the plasticity or the recovery rate of the nervous system. It's also your congenital sensitivity or insensitivity to stimulus at your nociceptors is a genetic trait. The production and effect of opiates on your system is a genetic trait. So there's no such thing as a person being a whiner, I guess is what I'm trying to say. That think of for all of your patients that they bring into their external stressor situation a genetic and a non-genetic internal stress environment that is really initially outside of their control. I say initially because we're going to look at ways to bring it inside their control. Some individuals are unaware of their responses. The tissues themselves, the somatic dysfunctions, vary in degree and type from person to person. Some individuals heal efficiently, some individuals heal inefficiently, and can remain chronically inflamed. And these also are going to contribute to the variety of responses. We all in the IPA love this cartoon. Some individuals are disabled by things that other individuals just keep going through. Yeah, Clem, I hurt. But you know, it's kind of a good hurt. Now that we've looked at how information gets in and things that control how the brain will determine what it means, let's look at what are some of the responses the brain might therefore generate to the conclusion that it's drawn. Peripheral or internal responses, whatever the central nervous system decides is in your best interest, will protect you the most, will restore homeostasis the quickest, that will be the output. It might be an immune response, thoughts, movement, pain, endocrine, autonomic, chemical responses, and I would ask you to look and see that pain, again an output of the brain, is one of a myriad of responses the brain can choose from, but doesn't have to choose. The brain might decide that the essential response right now is an external motor reaction The brain says, you got to get moving. It signals the motor cortex, the long muscles tighten, and away you go. Run is the essential response. The brain may decide it needs to throw this into the prefrontal and make a little bit more cognitive reasoning out of it. Okay, you just hurt yourself. Could it be infected? Do you need stitches? Are you going to die? Or, no, I think I can take care of this at home. The cortex may decide, the brain may decide in all those different areas put together, what we need is an autonomic response. And it may generate a parasympathetic response. I need you to just relax. The cool it response, where you can rest and relax and heal. On the other hand, the brain may determine that it's in your best interest to get away from the tiger, and it's going to start a sympathetic response. So you're going to crank out adrenaline, your heart rate's going to go up, your lung muscles are going to tighten, and you are going to move. You are going to fight. Either way, the brain is going to support that decision with an endocrine response. If it was a parasympathetic, or if it was a sympathetic response, then the brain is going to go through a chain reaction to try and support that sympathetic response. The brain to the pituitary. Pituitary produces ACTH, which then stimulates the adrenals to produce cortisol and to produce adrenaline. So what are the responses from that? Number one, decreased GI activity and sex drive, because who needs that when you're running from a tiger? Increased heart rate, tighten the lung muscles, release glucose for energy. Your cortisol causes the release of that glucose, that adrenaline, so it's going to pump up that heart rate and get that system going into overdrive. What if it was a parasympathetic response? The brain has the endocrine system back that up as well. So the brain tells the pituitary to produce endorphins. The brain tells the pineal, let's make some melatonin. Now, I think we all know that melatonin helps us sleep. What you may not know is that melatonin is one of the most powerful antioxidants that can operate on the body. And the most powerful antioxidant for the body is one that's called glutathione. Glutathione is the primary antioxidant for the central nervous system, and it cannot be produced in the absence of melatonin. The brain will also trigger the parathyroids to produce PTH, which is a hormone that is essential in the production or the activation of vitamin D. And vitamin D, once again, is an extremely powerful antioxidant. All of this to say that the brain is determined your endocrine system should help your parasympathetic response by decreasing your pain, helping you sleep, and helping you heal. There are local tissue responses that I would want you to keep in mind as well. That the blood vessels initially will constrict so that you don't bleed to death, coagulate, and produce healing factor. Secondarily, it will move into vasodilation. This is necessary so that the immune cells can migrate into the area and start the cleanup process. Locally then, we have our pro-inflammatory cytokines, which is a chemical that excites and draws the local and subsequently the peripheral immune cells to get into that area, eat out the damaged tissue so that healing can start occurring into that area. It also hypersensitizes our nociceptors, so you'll leave that area alone. Nociceptive C fibers are located in bone, skin, muscle, connective tissue, viscera, blood vessels, and when stimulated, they produce substance P and other peptides that are going to, again, reinforce that local inflammatory response, that immune response that is so essential for healing to occur. There's another local tissue response that deals with our connective tissue system in that it facilitates that collagen fiber turnover, our synthesis of our collagen locally, increasing cross-sectional fiber area of our collagen fibers, in other words, bigger, stronger collagen fibers, and therefore helps us decrease our susceptibility to re-injury. There are a few maladaptive responses that can occur that I want us to keep in mind, one local and one central. Locally, if a sensory nerve, a nociceptive nerve, is damaged, then that area can start firing at abnormal locations. We're going to talk more later on how this can affect our perception of damage and our perception of where we should be responding pain-wise to. Centrally, sensory fibers, if they've been locally damaged, centrally those neurons may die out, and when that happens, that feeds to the smudging effect. Surrounding neurons will innervate into that now absent area. So an area that formerly represented your hand may actually be facilitated when you stimulate a different part of the body. So let's say the neck neurons overflow into the hand area. Or let me do it the reverse. That the hand neurons overflow into the neck. Maybe this is an example of why I might be using my hand and it makes my neck hurt, because the brain is misreading where the input is coming from. Now that we've talked about external stimuli, we should move into talking about our internal stimuli, and what you're going to find is it's the exact same system. Let's look first at how does stimuli get from the inside to the inside. So internally, how are we facilitating the brain to make it draw some kind of context? Thoughts and emotions set off the same neurons as the physical or mechanical external stressors do without any input from the body. In a moment, we'll look at the mirror neurons that will explain this for us. Secondly, memories, recognition, imagination can also all set off the same neurons as external mechanical stressors, again, without any input from the body. How do these things happen? Well, research shows us that in your brain, 25% of the cells in every area of your brain can be fired whether you use that area, so let's say whether I use my hand, or whether I think about using my hand, or see someone's hand move, the neuron fires the same. I want to tell you about the research that first highlighted mirror neurons, and this is a story that I heard from David Butler. The initial research, they were doing functional MRI on a monkey, and they were having the monkey eat a banana, and doing the MRI to determine what areas of the brain will light up with fire that are part of the experience for a monkey of eating a banana. And they were mapping those. The monkey had finished the banana. And while they were still in place, a researcher came into the lab, of all things, eating a banana. The monkey saw the researcher eating the banana, and all of a sudden, all the exact same neurons began firing. And this started the research into mirror neurons. In a large part, Feldenkrais also spoke to this. He identified that whether you use a certain set of muscles or whether you imagine using a certain set of muscles, it will create the same changes in the tissues. We now know that that's through our mirror neurons that occurs. There are chemical triggers. Adrenaline, whether it's produced by stress, mechanical stress, or emotions, is a very powerful stimulant to the dorsal root ganglia. Now, the dorsal root ganglia is crazy enough on a good day, but if you dump adrenaline into the system, it goes super nuts, and so the brain is buried in information from the dorsal root ganglia in the presence of adrenaline, even though there's actually no tiger. There is an immunological way of stimulating nerves. That means that whether you are having a virus or whether you're having stress related to cytokine release, again, your neurons will fire, the nociceptors will fire as if there was an external stressor coming into the system. So what I hope that you can appreciate now is when we talk about internal stress, there's no such thing as somebody, you know, being, how best to say this? A lot of times we think that people, when they're under internal stressors, we think of them as either being strong in character or weak in character. What I want you to appreciate is that the person's character has nothing to do with the system's response to internal stressors. It just is. It is genetically and non-genetically and physiologically determined that you will respond to stressors. What is the context that the brain brings it into? How does the brain process these internal stressors? Every piece of information that comes into the brain at the same time can be clustered together and held as a grouping. Back in 1990, Melzack called this a pain memory. Later, in the 1999, when he coined the neuromatrix term, he called this a neurosignature. It's also known in the literature as a neurotag. Again, a neurosignature or a neurotag recognizes that all of these are together equal a certain experience that we've just had. And I like to say that a neurotag or a neurosignature is like the brain's family album. It's a neurotag is a photograph of the sights and sounds and smells, the pressures, the temperatures, the chemicals, the thoughts, the mechanical external input that occurs in every moment of your life, and that it's stored there in that album for you to go back and look at later. We'll talk about what that means in a moment. So, what is the consequence of us taking these photographs and saving this photograph album? Well, every variable is clustered together when a patient injures themselves. The time of day, the temperature that they were in at the time, the people that were in the room with them, the location, the peripheral stimuli, the external stressors coming in, everything is in that snapshot. So as you go through life, let's say, just to make our life easy, that there's five things that are in this neurosignature. This, 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 and this. If any one of these gets fired, because it's probably shared with a lot of other guys, overlapping neurotags or neurosignatures, if this guy gets fired, the brain might decide, I don't need to wait for the other four. I know they're coming. I'm going to fire the same response that I did the last time I got those five in. So in other words, the entire neurotag can be fired, causing the brain to respond when it's just one input that came in, one component of the neurotag. I call this a rush to judgment. The brain rushes to judge because it's processing billions and trillions of pieces of information, and we don't want it to do it one at a time. But when it rushes to judgment then, what you'll find is, if it was cold when you injured yourself, then just being in cold temperatures can make your pain worse. If you had a lot of muscle tension when you injured yourself, then that will be part of the response that you have. If you had increased heart rate and increased adrenaline production when you hurt yourself, then that will be the brain's response this time. If your previous response was pain, then when you look at that picture, that neurotag, then you're going to feel pain. What are the responses then? We've looked at how the internal gets to the internal. We've looked at how the brain clusters all of the stimuli together, internally and external stimuli, to come up with a photograph that it can refer back to and then run a game plan. What is the appropriate regulated response given the neurotag that we've just fired? What's important for you to understand is it doesn't matter. There's no difference between the responses at the brain's command for external and the responses for internal. They're the same. Even more importantly, when that response gets fired, The patient can't tell, did he get fired because of an external or an internal stimuli? So internal and external stressors are going to produce the exact same options of response from the brain. Let's look now at the compensations and adaptations that occur in reference to chronic stress and chronic pain. We've looked about in the general sense, so let's summarize for our chronic pain patients. Remember that all the systems of the body are going to be impacted. If we look first at the central nervous system, remember that with chronic inflammation or sustained firing of our nociceptors, the dorsal root ganglia is going to become facilitated. This means that it's going to go off even more, sending information up to the brain, the central processor. Secondly, remember that we talked about smudging and the spread of excitability along the homunculus. So again, in chronic pain, that nociceptive representation field in that sensory cortex is going to enlarge so that non-injured areas are going to be brought into the pain experience, giving the patients that sense that their pain is spreading. Alterations in the motor cortex are occurring, so there's a delayed firing in our core musculature. This may underlie part of the mechanism in Hodges's research, demonstrating that once someone has been in pain, that the core muscles are inhibited and do not come back in until they're facilitated. The central nervous system, in its sensory component, the sensory threshold is going to become changed. Remember, this is our allodynia, where non-painful or non-damaging information is perceived as threatening to the central nervous system. We spoke to the gray matter in the prefrontal cortex becoming diminished. And remember that this is going to affect your patient's ability to consciously modulate their pain. But again, that this can be reversed through our education with the patient. There's going to be a chemical support in the central nervous system for both depression as well as anxiety for the patient's ability to remember and to process. A hyperactivity of the prefrontal cortex, and even EEG findings that painful words cause a heightened firing pattern within the cortex. I apply this in the clinic by when my patients come in, I don't ask them about their pain, I ask them about more neutral things. How were your exercises? Which one did you find most helpful to try and not feed that upload of the nervous system? I've said upload several times, so let me define what that is. By that in the literature, we mean central sensitization, that the cortex is now in a heightened state for firing. So it has a maladaptive ability to inhibit the dorsal root ganglia. It has enhanced temporal summation, meaning that it's easier to fire those neurons. It has increased long-term potentiation, meaning that it's harder to suppress that activity, and a heightened sensitivity to our mechanical forces. Maybe that explains why the patient's been able to sit a certain way in the past and not hurt, but now they're hypersensitive to bad postures and inefficient movements. If we look at our peripheral nervous system, remember that there's going to be a change in our nociceptors locally, a change in their ion channels, and an increased ability to fire those receptors. Our autonomic nervous system, one of the worst changes that occurs is in my favorite chemical, that adrenaline. When you have a facilitated autonomic nervous system, you're going to have chronic adrenaline production. Let's look at what that sustains. High blood pressure, inflamed tight tissues, hyperactivity in that dorsal root ganglia, and we know that's going to feed central sensitization, that there's going to be a change in the nerves firing in the wrong places. There's going to be changes in our blood pressure so that we're going to have more tissue ischemia and therefore the perception of damage. Decreased memory and healing, increased depression and despair, decreased physical performance, poor digestion, and a suppressed sex drive. So in the presence of chronic pain and chronic stress, our patients are losing that ability to heal. that ability to cope with the situation, and they're moving away from their support systems. Remember that the adrenaline system is fired by the cortex to support that autonomic nervous system, and so many of the same changes are going to occur because of chronic cortisol production. Cortisol, remember, is produced to increase glucose stores to keep fueling this system. There'll be a breakdown in proteins, leading to weakness and potentially to myopathies. An inhibition in calcium absorption, so now we're really weakening that musculoskeletal system and progressing with degenerative joint disease much faster in these patients. And here it is again, altered healing and memory, depression, despair, decreased physical performance, poor appetite, altered sex drive, and that sustained adrenaline production once again. The immune system is called into play, and I've often thought, I wonder if chronic pain is actually an autonomic disturbance. It's like an autonomic disorder. When we have a chronically active immune system, we're going to have chronic inflammation. That means that the peripheral and central nervous systems, it's like they're walking around with a sunburn all the time. So any input coming in really facilitates a hyper response. There'll be a buffering of your opiates, so you're less able to control your own pain. There'll be stripping of myelin from the nerves, and this feeds into that altered nerve firing capacity at the wrong locations. There'll be a smudging of the homunculus that we've already discussed. There'll be increased pressure in nerves, and this affects their circulation and a buildup of waste products. Of interest is that the central nervous system and peripheral nervous system combined utilize 25% of your cardiac output. The nervous system is a very bloodthirsty system, and when it becomes ischemic, you develop pain as a result of that. Production and exchange of our ion channels that we discussed, and a decrease in brain plasticity. In other words, a decrease in the brain's ability to change and adapt itself. The circulatory system is affected by way of affecting those other systems. So in review, increased adrenaline is going to increase our blood pressure and reduce the blood pressure to our tissues for healing. That in the presence of an immune response being sustained, we're going to have a secondary vasodilatation that's going to lead to a sustained inflammatory state. And remember that increased inflammation equals increased nociceptor firing. Inflammation alone can result in the patient perceiving that the damage is still there. Our soft tissues and skeletal system are discussed in more detail in our connective tissue lecture, but let's summarize a few points that we know here. Our connective tissues are going to be negatively impacted by those too low or too high external stressors. That if we have too high mechanical stress coming into the system, it's going to lead to increased cytokine production. That means increased immune activity, which leads to that collagen breakdown and the breakdown of our skeletal system. We're going to have changes in our cartilage. Excessive mechanical external stress is going to decrease our proteoglycan production, resulting in necrosis of those tissues. Our ability of our collagen fibers to slide on each other, what we in the IPA call muscle play, is going to be altered if there's excessive mechanical stress. Perhaps this is one of the reasons that we find such alteration in connective tissue mobility at those mechanical stress points that Greg will discuss in his structural lecture. Connective tissues have got to be our great shock absorber, as we discuss in our connective tissue lecture. And the flexibility and mobility, the stiffness of our connective tissues is affected when we have chronic external stress. One of the things, though, I want us to move into is also a concept that the musculoskeletal, the soft tissue, connective tissues of the body are altered in how we use them. In other words, in our functional movement patterns. Functional movement pattern is or functional holding pattern is a term that Greg coined back in 1980. So let's define it. A functional holding pattern is an alteration in posture or movement due to excessive or unnecessary muscle activity, and it certainly is going to contribute to structural deviations in our patient's symptomatology. Functional holding patterns come from external and internal sources and can cause muscle contractions, changes in breathing patterns, changes in visceral responses. If we look at this young man as an example of our emotional responses, this is a young man who was a stutterer, and he was brought by his parents to the clinic to see if we could help improve his posture. Certainly external stressors have an impact here, but we can't ignore the internal stressors that this young man faces from a day-to-day standpoint. Look at how his posture mirrors moving away from society or moving into himself. And think about that there are areas in the brain devoted to that sense of self, and how are they impacted by the internal stressors he faces daily. This lady came to the clinic because she was having that trapezius pain. But the whole time we were evaluating her, she kept talking about how much her coworkers had turned against her. That they'd been her friends, that she'd been promoted, and now they were all jealous and out to get her. And as she spoke, the shoulders got higher and higher. Remember, our thoughts and our attitudes can create changes within our entire body. A third type of functional holding pattern comes through the power of emulation. And when you look at this gentleman, I'll bet you can guess what his father did for a living. And if you guess something in the military, you would be correct. Sometimes emulation produces a functional holding pattern that is conscious, but most often it will create an unconscious holding pattern. And this is something that we can educate and highlight to our patients as well. Let's go to an expert, Peanuts. Charlie Brown says, "This is my depressed stance. When you're depressed, it makes a lot of difference how you stand. The worst thing you could do is to straighten up and hold your head up, because then you're going to start to feel better. If you're going to get any joy out of being depressed, you've got to stand like this." Functional holding patterns as part of those internal stressors. So how can we try to incorporate the concept of internal stressors when we work with our patients? And for me, one of the best ways is by using the loss cycle. By looking at where that patient may be in that loss cycle, it gives us insight into the internal stressors that are operating. We could start with the shock phase, and these are individuals that are going to appear disconnected from the external stressors as they've been on. I think of the lady who injured herself in a car accident and kept going to the gym and weightlifting, perpetuating the external damage because she was trying to fit into her wedding dress. This is clearly a person in that shock phase. I need to educate them on the role that internal stressors are playing and how they affect the healing process. We move to the distress phase, and it's difficult to miss these patients. They're high emotion patients. Often they'll come in and they appear very angry or very sad in their presentation. And we've looked time and again at how alterations in the chemicals that are produced by internal stress, it affects our ability to heal, our memory, our ability to process, and our emotions of depression and despair. These individuals are under very powerful internal stressors, and the best thing that I can do for them is to educate them, one, in the loss cycle, giving them a copy of this, and educating them in that neuromatrix model in how these are actual chemical responses that we can bring under control. The next phase is the phase that you have strong emotions, the disorganization phase. We generally hate these patients. They come at Tuesday for last Friday's appointment. They don't do their exercises, or they do something exercise-wise that you would never have taught anyone. This is actually what neuropsychologists know as neural disorganization. These are individuals who cannot process the best path through a particular problem. And again, we've seen the role of adrenaline, the role of cortisol, how these things change that person's ability to move to that final phase of acceptance, where the patient can be a very active participant. How do we use this information in helping our patients and looking at those internal stressors? It helps us, first of all, in recognizing that internal stressors are playing a role. By educating them in the loss cycle and by educating them in the neuromatrix and the role that internal and external stressors have, we can move that patient towards homeostasis, towards a wellness situation. So Greg says that our goal as therapists is to help that patient restore their wellness. But restoring or resolving our symptoms and restoring function for them throughout their lives. That our patients have got to be an active participant, and we can't do that without educating them. They're the investigator and they're the test pilot of our ideas. If they don't understand why they should do it and the role that all of these things play, then the person is not going to reach as high a level as they could. Research is very clear that education in the impact of internal and external stressors and in how the brain processes its information decreases the intensity of a patient's pain and increases their healing rate so that it decreases the length of time that they are in pain. We have to be facilitators for our patients. We can't do it passively. We can't do it to them. We have to do it with them. That education is our most powerful tool that we have. Whether it's education about their external stressors, their postures, and their movements. As you go through the course, you'll learn that we look for, is it mechanical, is it neuromuscular, or is it a motor control issue? And educating the patient to correct the appropriate aspect is what moves them towards healing. We've got to educate on stressors, external and internal. I've got to be a motivator. It's not enough to educate. It's not enough to tell the patient. We've got to sell the patient. Not in just anything, but in what we know is the science of wellness for them. Greg would remind us that we're students of motion, sculptors of structure, and facilitators of function.